Volume 8, we've seen Chandragupta create the first Indian Empire in India. In China, we've seen the first empire created by the Emperor Qi, and it was known as the Qin Dynasty, and he also created the Great Wall, one of the ancient wonders of the world. In the Middle East, the Greek dynasties that were established there are still in power. The Ptolemies and the Seleucid dynasties were warring against each other for the last 100 years, and the Seleucids have become the dominant power now in Asia Minor.
And in the West, Rome has finally controlled all of the Italian peninsula, plus the islands of Sardinia, Corsica, and Sicily. And Rome has already had one war with Carthage, the powerful city-state that is on the Western Mediterranean. And these two will meet again. The outcome will see who will be the masters of the Western Mediterranean.
The most illustrious member of the Maurya dynasty was Chandragupta's grandson, Ashoka. Ashoka began his career in the tradition of his father and grandfather by making war, but after a bloody campaign that destroyed and enabled him to absorb a rival kingdom, the character of his government changed abruptly. King Ashoka publicly expressed his sorrow for the suffering his armies had caused and announced his decision to forswear violence. But at the same time, he affirmed his determination to be accepted and obeyed as a legitimate sovereign.
By successful diplomatic overtures, he won submission from most of the remaining states of the subcontinent until his dominion extended from Afghanistan and Kashmir in the north to Mysore in the southern Deccan. Thus, for the first time, nearly all of India was brought under a central administration. Ashoka's conquests, however, were the aspect of his reign that he considered least important. Attracted to the Buddhist teachings, he sent commissioners throughout the kingdom to inquire into the needs of the people, teach them religion, and report on their spiritual progress. Although he was earnest in his support of Buddhism, Ashoka made religious toleration a state policy and urged that the Brahmins of all the Hindu sects be treated with respect. Ashoka's patronage during his long reign contributed markedly to the growth of the Buddhist religion. Ashoka's extraordinary administrative system did not long survive him.
Rome won Sicily, Corsica, and Sardinia, but Carthage did not accept the defeat. In 218 BC, Carthage hit back under one of the most feared warriors Rome would ever face, Hannibal. And this time, the target was Rome itself.
Hannibal was a man clearly with tremendous determination, a great personal hatred of Rome, which he'd inherited from his family, who'd fought the Romans before.
Hannibal became commander-in-chief of the Carthaginian army in 221 BC, and success was his from the outset. He masterminded the storming of a city belonging to the Romans at Saguntum in Spain after an 8-month siege. Goaded beyond restraint by this new young upstart, Rome declared war again in 218 BC. In a swift and decisive move, Hannibal embarked on his epic march from Spain to Italy. The pages of history were about to be altered forever. Hannibal had his winter headquarters at Nova Carthago. A move on Rome meant crossing the Alps. Traditional military thinking would have said, wait for spring, then move. But Hannibal, great general that he was, understood the value of surprise. He would move in winter, come what may.
Hannibal marched his army through Spain and France and across the Alps into Italy, accompanied by 36 elephants.
Most of Hannibal's elephants died on the journey over the Alps, and fact, his elephants played absolutely no role in the subsequent campaign. Nevertheless, they represent the skill and boldness that Hannibal portrayed in coming over the Alps so early in the campaigning season and surprising the Romans.
We're planning to go over the Alps. Hannibal questioned how will they supply the troops. His friend and close relative, Margot, says, well, we'll just have to get them used to the idea of cannibalism. As people die, we can then eat the dead soldiers and move on. So you can see how a reputation may have arisen of cruelty.
By late autumn, the weather in the mountains is already as bad as the worst winter at sea level. Hannibal's men spent 3 days constructing a road through the snow and ice of the Alps, but they battled on, and the 20,000 infantry and 6,000 cavalry reached the Po plains of northern Italy 5 months after leaving Nova Carthago. Having showed his skill as a strategist, Hannibal was now to prove his brilliance as a commander. In doing so, he would instill such great fear in the Romans that his name would be forever remembered. At the River Trebia, he skillfully used his knowledge of the topography to enable him to slaughter the Roman legions. But Hannibal himself would not emerge unscathed. He lost the sight in one eye, but it did not restrict his ability as a commander. The next year, 218 BC, he repeated his successful actions further south at Lake Trasimene. Once more, Livy recalled the event. For 3 long and bloody hours, the fight continued, and most furiously about the person of the Roman commander, Flaminius. A mounted trooper, putting spurs to his horse, cut down the armor bearer who had tried to check his murderous intent and drove his lance through Flaminius's body. The consul's death was the beginning of the end. Panic ensued. Men tried blindly to escape by any possible way, plunged into the edge of the lake till the water was up to their necks, and they were either drowned or, struggling back, exhausted into the shallow water, were butchered wholesale by mounted troops who rode in to meet them. The Romans lost 15,000 men. 2,000 were taken prisoner. The following year, the slow progress of the Carthaginian army through Italy continued. Hannibal moved on again, down to Apulia on the Adriatic coast, laying waste the land as he passed.
The Roman defeat at Lake Trasimene had several serious consequences. In the first place, the consul, Flaminius, was killed in battle. Then the other consul attempted to send reinforcements, which arrived 3 days late and also were wiped out by Hannibal. The end result, of course, is that morale at Rome plummeted. They weren't used to losing, and yet they'd had the news of 2 major disasters.
Hannibal seemed to be unstoppable.
Hannibal had about 40,000 troops, while the Romans and their allies had nearly twice that number. But Hannibal was a master tactician. When the Roman legions made their usual thrust towards his center,
as the heavy infantry are clashing in the center, the Romans are pushing the Spaniards and the Celts back. But then Hannibal's left cavalry are launched and hit the Roman right, which gives way under the weight of numbers. As Hannibal's infantry is being forced back, Hannibal's cavalry on the wings are winning the battles and forcing the Romans back. As the crescent is holding, the Africans on their extreme wings start wheeling around toward the back of the Romans.
Hasdrubal takes the Carthaginian cavalry and stops them from pursuing the Romans and moves them around the rear of the Romans as well. And the Romans now become surrounded.
A disaster for the Roman army. Some 50,000 Romans and allies were killed. There was panic in Rome, with cries of Hannibal is at the gates. But Hannibal was never able to capture Rome, because Rome's ingenious policy of creating allies paid off once again.
What defeats Hannibal is the fact that the Romans have got 8, 9, 10 times as many men able to be pressed into the army as Hannibal has got, and they can lose 50,000 men in a day, and they keep on fighting because they've got the manpower, and no other state in the ancient world could ever achieve anything like that.
Rome practiced total war against Hannibal. As an emergency measure, it called up every available man, even slaves, and sent legions to Carthage-held Spain to stop supplies and reinforcements from reaching Hannibal.
The wars on this scale are fights for survival, literally for survival. If you lose these kind of wars in the early period, your city is destroyed, your women and children are dispersed across the Mediterranean world. That's the end of it. All societies are destroyed if battles are lost.
But now Hannibal's touch began to desert him. Now he had his enemy at his mercy. Inexplicably, he did not capitalize on his successes at Cannae by marching on Rome. Instead, he allowed his men to spend time in the devastation of the rich Italian farmland. As they did so, the lazy progress of Hannibal's army through Italy continued.
He made a rapid march on Rome, which of course was meant to shock the Romans, which indeed it did. It caused great panic. There was never any question of him being able to march on Rome and taking it by force anyway.
Town after town fell to Hannibal and his Celtic warriors, but the Roman armies facing him on the field could not pin him down to another major battle. Crucially, he did not make the lightning strike on Rome, which would surely have won victory for Carthage. Instead, he besieged Tarentum. This was to prove the largest city to fall to Hannibal. Its capture further reduced the waning Roman influence in the heel of Italy. But it was not Rome. By 211 BC, the moment arrived that all Rome had been dreading. Hannibal was finally marching on Rome, and this was to be a turning point in the war. But he who hesitates is lost. Hannibal was now to suffer the consequences of that sage advice. His hesitation was to have grave consequences for him and his city. The wheel of fortune was about to turn against him. He had missed his chance. Rome was once again gathering her military strength. Instead of assaulting Rome, Hannibal turned aside from its great walls. It is a moment in history historians will debate forever. Once more, he fell to plunder and devastated the surrounding countryside. Hannibal, it seemed, had lost the masterful touch that was the hallmark of the initial years of the campaign. He was never to regain the momentum of the early successes. Little by little, the Romans began to gain the upper hand, recapturing territory they had lost to Hannibal. Inexorably, the tide was turning. The Romans now had the initiative, and Hannibal's responses were like those of a tired boxer in the last round of a world title bout. Hannibal was pushed back and back until he was hemmed into the port of Bruttium. From there, he quietly slipped out and set sail for Africa. Hardly a fitting end for an expedition that had begun so triumphantly, and made the world tremble.
One of the amazing things about Rome as a military power is that Rome was able to draw onto such massive resources of manpower and indeed financial resources as well.
The struggle between Rome and Carthage for the control of the Mediterranean, predicted by King Pyrrhus of Epirus in 275 BC, raged for much of the 3rd century. The consul Nero defeated Hannibal's brother Hasdrubal, and now Hannibal was outnumbered and short of supplies at the tip of Italy. In Spain, the Roman armies were led by a brilliant young general, Cornelius Scipio, and he cleared the Carthaginians from Spain and negotiated an alliance with 2 Numidian chieftains. The following year, Scipio invaded Africa with an army of 26,000 legionaries and 2,000 cavalry.
And at dawn the next day, he led his men into a ferocious and, for Hannibal, calamitous battle. From Hannibal's point of view, the battle went wrong from the outset when he ruthlessly drove back the Carthaginian front line. These men finally broke and attacked their own second line in a frenzied attempt to escape. They, in turn, were caught between the Romans and the third line of Carthaginians with their leveled spears. The Romans regrouped and advanced across the ground that was now slippery with blood and choked with bodies. The veterans of the Cannae slaughter came face to face with Hannibal's veterans, and the fighting was bitter and pitiless. It ended only when Scipio's cavalry returned to charge from the rear and cut the Carthaginian lines to pieces. The two generals met amidst the carnage of the field. For Hannibal, it was a tragic end to an illustrious career. Reluctantly, he advised his political masters to sue for peace. The Second Punic War was over.
The Carthaginian Empire, founded over 400 years before, was ended. Rome was now dominant in Spain and North Africa, as well as in Sicily, Sardinia, and Corsica. The Western Mediterranean was clearly a Roman sea. Rome now turned her attention to the control of the Eastern Mediterranean and the conquest of the Greeks, who acted as allies of Carthage.
To conceal the site of Cin's tomb forever, all who knew its secrets were sealed within its walls. Fifteen years of chaos followed Cin's death. In 206 BC, a new dynasty called the Han rose to power.
Now, Rome had clashed with Philip V of Macedon when he cautiously allied himself with Carthage, and Roman military commitments had stopped them from dealing with Greece, and they made peace. However, after the Battle of Zama, the Romans did not wish for a bad neighbor on the other side of the Adriatic, let alone one who often emerged as the ally and a patron of the pirates. Pretexts for intervention in Greek and Macedonian affairs were not far to seek. Since 273 BC, Rome had been on friendly terms with the Ptolemaic dynasty of Egypt. Ptolemy's succession difficulties had now arisen, and with avid opportunism, Philip had allied himself to Antiochus III, who ruled Syria, the rump of the Seleucid Empire, in attempt to seize the Ptolemy's overseas possessions. As usual, in a struggle between the successor powers, would-be neutrals were reluctantly involved, and Rhodes and Pergamon, a Greek Asiatic kingdom of culture and dignity, which had recently stemmed the Celtic inroads and which also defied the Seleucids, appealed to Rome for help. The Roman commander who eventually took charge in Greece was Titus Quintius Flaminius, an ardent Philhellene. He finally defeated Philip at the Battle of Sisos Philae in Thessaly. Rome's terms with Philip were not unduly severe, but war already loomed with Antiochus, his eastern ally. The logic of Rome's military expansion is clear enough. For the sake of security and trade, Rome wanted peace in the eastern Mediterranean, but since she could not countenance any power strong enough to act as a peacemaker, she had to exert her own strength in this capacity. In the war which followed, Antiochus' fleets were unable to resist the Roman grappling and boarding tactics which had destroyed Carthaginian naval supremacy. On land, he was defeated first at Thermopylae, then at Magnesia in Lydia. This last battle proved decisive. The Roman legions, as at Zama, had the advantage of good allied cavalry support provided here by King Eumenes of Paragon. The peace terms which followed Magnesia reduced Antiochus to impotence as far as the Mediterranean was concerned, but Rome fought a third Macedonian war with Perseus, son of Philip V. The decisive battle, which finally established Rome as arbitrator of the eastern Mediterranean world, came at Pydna in Macedonia. The pikemen of the Macedonian phalanx were again at a disadvantage on broken ground, and the Roman legionary swordsmen were able to exploit gaps in their ranks. Rome's victories in these eastern wars cannot be understood unless it is realized that the ponderous Macedonian phalanx of the 2nd century differed completely from the original flexible and mobile phalanx of the Philip II and Alexander the Great. With the growing tendency towards heavier weapons and armor, it in effect reverted in character to the rigid Greek phalanx of the 5th century. But the Romans, unlike the Macedonians, had developed consistently in the direction of flexibility. Their legionaries could wheel about, change direction faster, and still remain in formation quicker than the cumbersome phalanx could.
Rome now sought the death of Carthage, the only way she could see to end the rivalry forever. The Carthaginians finally gave Rome the excuse she needed when she went to war with one of her neighbors. Despite doing all in their power to try to comply with Rome's wishes, the Carthaginians could not meet the unreasonable demands of the Romans. A Carthaginian delegation to the Senate began to understand the danger from Rome the moment they heard the chilling address. Bear with fortitude the final commands of the Senate. Surrender Carthage to us and retire anywhere you like within your territory, provided that it is at least 10 miles from the sea. We have decided to raze your city to the ground. Faced with the prospect of complete annihilation, the proud Carthaginians would not yield without a struggle. They declared war on Rome and set about a hurried rearmoring. In an eerie parallel with the events in Germany before World War II, soon they were mass-producing shields, swords, missiles for catapults, spears and javelins, and as many catapults as they could. The Romans still believed Carthage to be almost defenseless. They believed that a simple assault would be sufficient to take the city. Taking their leisure, the Roman army arrived and camped in front of the defenses, but it was not to be as simple as they imagined. Three attempts to take the city were repulsed. Using a huge battering ram, the Romans smashed their way through the outer defenses, but a determined counterattack by the Carthaginians threw them back. These attacks and counterattacks dictated the course of a protracted war which would drag on for the next 3 years. Finally, in 146 BC, Scipio was in a position to deliver the final blow to the city. And when it came, it brought with it the most brutal and bloody street fighting recorded in ancient history. The final and grimmest task for the Romans was to attack the citadel. There were three steep streets leading up to it, each lined with houses, every one of which had to be stormed to eradicate the vicious resistance from within. Bodies fell from roofs and windows to be impaled on spikes or swords below. Roman assault troops flooded in, wave upon wave of them, replacing exhausted or wounded comrades. Scipio ordered that all houses should be burned, and this brought new horrors. The old, sick, and infirm perished in the flames, while the living and the dead were piled into holes to make the roads passable. After 7 gruesome days, the Carthaginian commander, Hasdrubal, surrendered. With the fiery spirit which had made the Carthaginians worthy adversaries, his wife, in disgust, cursed her husband as a coward and traitor. Rather than enter upon a life of slavery, she killed her 2 children and threw herself into the flames of her burning city. For 10 days, the fires raged. When the inferno subsided, Carthage had been wiped from the political map of the world.
When we go back to Carthage nowadays, what we see are the remains of Imperial Rome. Outside of modern Carthage, it's an area called Bursa. This is where we find the great amphitheatre, the baths built by the Roman Emperor Antoninus Pius in the 2nd century AD. So really, Carthage of the Carthaginians, you cannot see it except in the museum, in the material relics which have been found by excavation. Virtually nothing stands above ground.
They always convince themselves that they fight defensive wars. No Roman war, no matter how offensive or imperialist it might look to us, to the Romans, it was always a matter of defense, always fending off an attack. So in a sense, that's how they justified a Mediterranean conquest.
As rulers of a rapidly expanding empire, the legions had to get used to a lot of travel, and that meant travel on foot. When Roman soldiers marched, they carried up to 50 pounds of equipment on their backs, including weapons, armor, cooking utensils, rations, and tools for building a temporary camp. Most armies relied on natural defenses, but the Romans carried the tools to build a new camp wherever they were, a new one each day if necessary. They dug a defensive ditch around the whole camp, 5 feet wide and 3 feet deep, then built a palisade with the stakes they carried with them. It was as though the Romans had their own fortified city wherever they went.
The primary purpose of a Roman marching camp is psychological rather than military. It's the idea that in enemy territory, every night you make a small city in what is not your territory. And the enemy look on, seeing their territory pockmarked by the advance of Roman armies.
The camps were a classic example of the Romans' passion for order. Every camp had an identical plan. Each leather tent was put up in the same position each time, so that the soldiers knew exactly where they were.
The soldiers had a great sense of security during the night. They knew exactly where their officers were and the fact that their comrades were guarding them as well.
The Roman obsession with order extended to the discipline of the troops. Camp sentries who fell asleep could be stoned to death for having endangered the whole regiment.
It wasn't as exceptional as it might sound, given the general background of what Roman society was like. People were used to flogging, they were used to fairly frequent public executions. So the Roman army was indeed pretty draconian, but not as different from the rest of society as perhaps we might think.
One infamous form of harsh discipline was decimation, the killing of 1 man in 10 of regiments that showed cowardice in battle. The men were selected by lot and clubbed to death by their comrades. Roman obedience was based on fear.
Romans were unique in that they were not only disciplined fighters, but they were master builders and engineers. When they came upon a city, they would not only surround the city with their troops, but they would build walls around it, palisades, fortresses.
And they would keep the besieged entrapped inside their city for as long as it took till they surrendered. Now here's one example of a siege. The Romans would build base camps around the city. And in front of these camps, and sometimes behind them, they would build bunkers. and the bunkers would hold the sentries and the guards, and they would build trenches in between the vital sections where they can move up on the city, and then they would connect all these bunkers and camps together by walls. Scipio Africanus, the victor of Zama, was one of the first to build camps such as these, and since then the Romans would make it their standard operating practice, and they'd be known as sackers of cities.
The period from the end of the Punic Wars in 146 BC to about 30 BC was one of the most turbulent in the history of Rome. It was between these years that the nation reaped the full harvest of the seeds of violence sown during the wars of conquest. Bitter class conflicts, assassinations, desperate struggles between rival dictators, wars, and insurrections were the all too common occurrences of this time. Even the slaves contributed to the general disorder.
The first stage in the conflict between classes of citizens began with the ascendancy of the two Gracchi brothers. Though of aristocratic lineage themselves, the Gracchi strove for a program of reforms to alleviate the country's ills. They proposed a simple remedy of dividing state lands among the landless. The first of the brothers to take up the cause of reform was Tiberius. He was elected tribune in 133 BC. He proposed a law that restricted the current renters or holders of the state lands to a maximum of 300 acres per citizen plus 150 acres for each child in the family. The excess was to be confiscated by the government and given to the poor in small plots. Conservative aristocrats bitterly opposed this proposal and brought about its veto by Tiberius' colleague in the tribunate, Octavius. So what did Tiberius do? He removed Octavius from office, and when his own term had expired, he attempted to stand for re-election. Both of these moves seemed to threaten dictatorialism and gave the conservative centers excuse for violence. Armed with clubs, they went on a rampage during the elections and murdered Tiberius and 300 of his followers. 9 years later, Gaius Gracchus, the younger brother of Tiberius, renewed the struggle for reform. Though Tiberius' land law had finally been enacted by the Senate, Gaius believed that the campaign had to go further. Elected tribune in 123 BC and re-elected in 122, he procured the enactment of various laws for the benefit of the less privileged. The first provided for stabilizing the price of grain in Rome. A second law proposed to extend the franchise to Roman allies, giving them the rights of Latin citizens. Still a third gave the middle class the right to make up the juries that tried governors accused of exploiting the provinces. These and similar measures provoked so much anger and contention among the classes that riots broke out. Gaius was proclaimed an enemy of the state, and the Senate authorized the consuls to take all necessary steps for the defense of the Republic. In the ensuing conflict, Gaius committed suicide and about 3,000 of his followers were killed. The Gracchian turbulence had broad significance. It demonstrated, first of all, that the Roman Republic had outgrown its constitution. Instead of working out a peaceful accommodation to these changes, both sides resorted to violence. By so doing, they set a precedent for the unbridled use of force by any politician ambitious for supreme power, and thereby paved the way for the destruction of the Republic.
After the downfall of the Gracchi brothers, and as a consequence of the corruption that followed, two military leaders made themselves rulers of the state. The first was Gaius Marius, conqueror of Numidia, North Africa. He returned to Rome, and with the military backing him, he manipulated the Senate for his glory. But he also improved the military structure quite a bit.
The Roman army was a citizen militia organized on classical Greek lines. Time and time again, it was to prove no match for the ferocious Gallic charge. In 104 BC, however, in the wake of yet another defeat at the hands of a Celtic army, the Roman general Gaius Marius completely restructured the Republic's army. The short-service militiaman was replaced by a heavily equipped and well-trained professional soldier.
There is indeed evidence from antiquity that something very important happened in 105 to 104 BC. This is that because of very major military threats from the Celtic and Gallic and Germanic tribes to the north, Gaius Marius, who had already achieved success in defeating the Numidians in what is called the Jugurthine War, started to raise new soldiers in order to fight in the north.
With the restructuring by Marius, here at last was the backbone and foundation of an empire. On the battlefield, too, the army was thoroughly reformed. In place of the old system of lining up their army in three battle lines, it was organized into the famous legions of Rome. Each legion initially comprised of 10 cohorts or battalions. Ironically, in the early days, the men were often issued with Celtic-made mail shirt and helmet. But unlike the volatile Celtic warriors, the Romans were to learn to rely on discipline and sheer staying power to defeat their fearsome opponents. But it had been a long road. Southward migration of two tribes, the Cimbri and the Teutons, precipitated a crisis which would eventually lead to the destruction of the Celts.
By the time of Julius Caesar, the Roman armies in the field were very different to what they had been in the 2nd century BC. And I think the very crucial factor here is the change that resulted from a war called the Social War in 91 to 89 BC, as a result of which the entire population of Italy became Roman citizens. And that meant there was a much larger reservoir of manpower for the Romans to draw upon. It resulted in considerable problems for the Roman government, but I think this was one of a number of factors that led to a general change. Conscription did not, in fact, come to an end. We know that even under the emperors, there was still conscription of soldiers in the provinces. So I think it's a gradual change.
The new reformed Roman army proved to be ruthlessly efficient. In a brutal series of campaigns, the Cimbri and the Teutons were destroyed. Within 40 years, the boundaries of the Romans had been pushed northwards into France, driving the Celts back from the Mediterranean forever. It would not be long before their remaining homelands would be under threat.
The Latin cities in southern Italy were rioting for equal rights, and this turned into what was called the Social War, in which Sulla, a subordinate of Marius, was in command of southern Italy, and he was gaining impressive victories. Thus, after the Social War, Marius and Sulla were pitted against each other for the power in Rome. The ice broke when Mithridates, king of Pontus, invaded Bithynia, a client state of Rome in Asia Minor. In 88 BC, the Senate overlooked the aging Marius and elected Sulla to be Rome's leader in the east. But with Sulla out of Italy, Marius rallied his supporters in the Senate, and he had Sulla's appointment squashed, and in Sulla's place had himself named leader of the armies in the east. Sulla, in defiance to Marius' treachery, took his six legions that were in Greece heading to Asia Minor and turned them around, and for the first time in Rome's history, Roman armies marched on Rome. Sulla found that his legions were adherently loyal to him more so than to the Roman Senate. And Marius, fleeing for his life, managed to flee back to North Africa, and Sulla was now the most powerful man in Rome. But no sooner had Sulla left to deal with Mithridates again than Marius returned to Rome. And Marius murdered over 300 of Sulla's supporters. So Sulla quickly made a treaty with King Mithridates, and he hurried back to Rome to protect his power. And Sulla was not in time to save his supporters, and Marius' killing spree only ended with his sudden death in 86 BC. In reprisal, though, Sulla had Marius' supporters and families put to death. Sulla now forced the Senate to make him dictator. And he quickly set about reforms to give the Senate back power that they lost against the Gracchi brothers, so that no one could take over as he did. And after 3 years of peace and reforms, he retired to private life. Marius and Sulla set a precedent in Roman politics to gain leadership by bribes, paybacks, force, and murder. The Republic was finding it increasingly harder to keep their commanders in check.
The Senate's fears became a reality in 82 BC with the emergence of three more leaders. The first was Gnaeus Pompeius, who was governor in North Africa, and the Senate resented Pompey because he was elected by Sulla. However, Pompey's popularity was growing, and the Senate was glad to post him in far-off Spain. And Pompey set out to destroy Sertorius, which was the only good general left on Marius' side. So Sertorius established an independent state in Spain, and he successfully conducted guerrilla warfare. However, due to treachery, Sertorius was murdered, and Pompey destroyed his army. Now Pompey was gaining more and more fame, but Rome was experiencing a couple problems at this time. One of them was a slave revolt. And the Senate had to decide who to give the leadership to.
There was a slave revolt led by a gladiator named Spartacus. He had an army of 70,000 strong, and he was rampaging all over Italy, and he defeated a couple of Rome's legions. Then there were the pirates that were conducting warfare on the seas, and they were sinking the ships that were carrying grain from Egypt to Italy. And this was getting so severe that the cities in Italy were on the verge of starvation.
And in the east, there was the Second Mithridate War. Now, the first thing they decided to deal with was the Spartacus army rampaging all over Italy. There was an ambitious politician in Rome by the name of Crassus, and he saw this as his chance to gain power. And he took the four Roman legions that protect Rome, and he headed out to destroy the slave army of Spartacus. Now, there were some senators that did not wish to see Crassus become powerful and win this victory all by himself. So they worked to get Pompey out of Spain and come into Italy behind the slave army to help defeat them. Even though Crassus did not need the help, but this would steal some of the glory away from Crassus, and he would have to share it with Pompey. And so goes the treachery and politics in Rome. And to take Pompey's place in Spain was none other than Julius Caesar. And this would be the start of Julius Caesar's career. But for now, it is Pompey the Great who is the most popular, and Crassus trying to gain fame for himself. And thus, it would be these three people, Crassus, Pompey, and Caesar, which would become the dominant players in Rome's near future.
The Roman Senate finally gave the nobleman Marcus Crassus the power to quell the revolt. To show he was serious, he began by decimating two of the legions that had lost to Spartacus, then raised six new legions and met the Spartacans in open warfare. Thank you.
palace and Pompey.
Slaughter was enormous. We don't have the exact figures, but the survivors, of course, were sold into slavery, except for 6,000 of them, which were crucified along the Appian Road, the entrance into the city of Rome, to show all who dare to stand against Rome what would be their fate.
So Crassus would return to Rome and the Senate to be a very powerful leader. Pompey, they sent to deal with the pirate menace.
That Pompey Magnus would be the man to carry out the deed. Pompey was thought by some to be a bit of a double dealer, as this rare image seems to suggest. Compared to most politicians and generals of the day, he was actually rather mild. His simple approach was to use overwhelming force against the pirates. Pompey set out for Spain. For the next 9 months, all over the Mediterranean, he terrorized the pirates. 10,000 men were killed. Over 1,000 ships were burned. And 20,000 pirates were taken prisoner.
You can say that Pompey's early successes were due to a bit of luck, but this pirate campaign truly showed his generalship.
Now in the east was the Second Mithridate War, and Crassus had sent Lucullus to deal with that. Now during this war, he was exhausting his resources fighting King Pontus, which was being aided by the Parthians, and this forced Lucullus to fight defensively in forts. Now as he was planning to invade Parthia to stop the aid of the Mithridates, his forces were on the verge of mutiny. But just then Pompey arrived after defeating the pirates with fresh supplies and took over the war. And then he first allied himself with the Parthians and offered them the lands of Armenia
and Pompey then defeated the Mithraites. And then Pompey now annexed Syria and Palestine. And now he is known as Pompey the Great throughout the Roman Empire.
Daniel chapter 11, verses 1 through 36, talk of the 2 centuries when the Seleucid and Ptolemies dynasties fought each other, and Palestine was the battleground. And Jerusalem was a nice piece of real estate to collect as a prize whoever won the territory, because Jerusalem controlled the trade routes along the Mediterranean from Egypt to the east and vice versa. Now specifically concerning verse 30, it says the ships of Kittim comes against Syria, which is the Seleucid Empire under Antiochus IV. And Kittim is the island of Cyprus. And Cyprus was a huge island off the coast of Palestine that based fleets. That was their major commerce there. And whichever power happened to control Cyprus would get the use of those fleets. And right now it happened to be Rome. Unlike Alexander, who had to march along the coast here to protect his army from the Persian fleet, Pompey, he used the Cyprus fleets, and he blockaded the entire coast of the Eastern Mediterranean all the way from the Hellespont to Palestine. Verse 32 has to do with the Maccabean revolt, and these were the Jews who rebelled against Syrian rule. And they cleaned out the temples and destroyed all the idols in the territory of Samaria, and they retook their own temple in Jerusalem and dedicated it back to the Lord. And this is celebrated as Hanukkah, and thus they gained their independence around 134 BC. Now around 100 BC, 2 rivals arose in the Judean world. There was the older Hellenistic Jews who believed in the Greek philosophy and mixed it with Jewish ideas, and these were the Sadducees. And there was the Orthodox Jews who strictly believed in Judaism, and these were called the Pharisees. And civil war broke out among these 2 forces. And John Hycranius and his sons managed to expand the Judean frontier along the Philistine coast into the frontiers of Egypt and into the Transjordan region. And thus, all the territory that were controlled by King David and Solomon 1,000 years ago were now in the Judeans' hands once again. And Syria was now taken over by the Romans. Everything to the east of the Euphrates was controlled by the Parthian dynasty, which was the new Persian dynasty. Everything on the western side of the Euphrates was controlled by the Romans. But just as there seemed to be peace restored in Judea, civil war was once again threatening between the Sadducees and Pharisees, and so entered Pompey and the Roman army, and he went in to ensure peace and to further Roman aims. He laid siege to Jerusalem, and he breached the walls, and he fought his way to the temple, and it is there that it is believed that he slaughtered 12,000 Jews, and Jewish independence was forever wiped out. And Pompey, now known as Pompey the Great, went back to Rome as a hero and champion, and one of the most famous and powerful men in Rome.